my turn. So you want to know my name? I am called he who lives in a time far into the many suns, whose time has yet to unfold. I am he who lives in shadow. I am the dweller in the deep, Cthulhu. I am called king of the mountain and lord of the night. I am he who is most unclean, son of perdition, father of lies and keeper of the eternal place of punishment, who was judged before thee, wanderer between the place of rest and purgatory. I am called the exile and banished one, warlock and fallen one. I am called Apollyon and Abaddon, Shiva the destroyer, father of the seed of evil and most unholy one. The serpent of the garden of the first man, the hooded one set, the Assyrian serpent god. The Egyptians call me Apep and the Tibetan Mahakala. The Hindu call me Genshaw. I am called Helbin Shekhar and Shakaras, the adversary and accuser. I am called Yan Lawang and king of the underworld, both Hades and Anubis, who bore forth the scepter unto Osiris. My wolves are Gnasher and Bone Crusher, ox face and horse head that frighten children in their sleep with the sounds of unknown terror in the shadows of the night. They are the Boogeyman and Sandman and are evils that are as old as the earth. I am called the first one made in the heavens, the light bearer and shining one. I am he who answered the call of Odin's horn, who is called Loki, the god of mischief. I have as many names as there are stars in the sky, and eternity is my curse of both burden and torment. I am Yaldisar bad to some and chaos to others. Naglfar is my vessel and I, its captain. I who rode the tempest of war for hell follows closely behind thee. I am he who was cast down after thee but came before thee. Son of Bor, Galandria, and grandfather of Lok. Stands not in my path, for we are brothers and I am not the enemy.
Person in a mirror looking back, back, covered in blood, heart attack, covered in blood, grab the gat, put it to my devil but I don't pull the trigger cause I ain't ready to shoot myself in the head, realizing I'm a ghost and I'm watching the blood coagulate around my body cause I'm already dead. Blood, hole, dark, petal, lotus, flower, bitter, sour, blood, power, take, focus, dark, lotus.
Blood, seeds are the ones that pose, glass, you know, and I can go back and lay, popping a lotus and I'm picking the truth, knocking on loose with nothing to lose in months again. Together deep in your veins, spread out the open artery in the bloodprint we remain. It's better to have been all the bullshit that you're spitting is quite irrelevant. Life trying to turn the force on celibate and it all depends on who's getting it. Born again Christians, I don't miss this. Time to bear witness, though this sickness infecting the business, closing the distance. Fight for the goodness, play out the business.
In a pool of blood, my vision been red. Can't repent, I'm a grown man now, my mind in the flood. Mama said I've lost my sense, everywhere that I'm at all I hear, my head is the beat of a heart, I gotta make it quick. So I got me a knife and I stab a fool dead. It's just another life, and to me it ain't shit. Couple of minutes of peace, finally put all of this bullshit behind me. I wish it was just that simple, but it ain't, cause I'm still just a drunk of a rock of this pain. And fuck what you said, and fuck what you heard, and fuck apologies, too little, too late. So I take my fucking head to this, put your fucking head and watch your blood go where you turn.
Notice we'll explode this. And then Corotus, the souls from beyond the sun are the ones who provoke us, as was told to who done the lost son of Osmosis. So plant your seeds in that dirty mud, cause hell's be the grossest. So don't be scared to water them with blood. The stems will grow fast. The great knowledge of the future comes from knowing your past. The five petals of the pot come from the god you trust. Isn't it odd? This is forever dark. Lotus.
Thank you. Hondo grew weary of silently observing the unfolding events and decided to intervene. Determined to prevent the antagonists from bringing about their destructive utopia, he engaged in a fierce battle with Astaroth, the colossal Nanthulian beast. The clash of their swords created a shower of sparks, illuminating the transdimensional traveler's struggle against the formidable opponent. With a surge of power, Heimdall took flight and descended upon Astaroth, burying him deep within a crater. The impact shattered the ground, separating Astaroth's augmented genes from his physical form. In his moment of triumph, Heimdall suddenly heard a distinct click behind him. The blades of the spirit sword, with its ability to transcend dimensions, pierced through every plane of existence, slicing through Heimdall's very being. His all-seeing mind's eye, which watched over all realms, shattered under the relentless assault. As darkness closed in, Heimdall's last sight was Lucifer, standing ominously over him, witnessing this tragedy through his all-seeing eye. Odin suspected that Lucifer had fallen victim to the deceptions of Samael and Sargon, leading him down a treacherous path. Seeking justice for Heimdall's fall, Odin summoned the great archangel Michael and Zeus, informing them of the dire situation. Michael swiftly retrieved the chains from the location Odin mentioned, intending to confront Lucifer before matters escalated further. However, unbeknownst to them, Fenrir, the watchful observer, had been monitoring the events. Thanks to Lucifer's warnings, Fenrir, now free from his chains, seized the opportunity to exact his long-awaited revenge. Without hesitation, he lunged at Odin, tearing him apart before the other gods could react. Loki, seemingly unperturbed, dusted himself off, while Hera emerged from her years of false imprisonment, climbing out from where Aphrodite had held her captive. With a foreboding air, Hera declared, "Now, it begins, the end of all things," snapping her fingers as they vanished into the darkness. In the depths of the Sistine Chapel in Italy, a solitary figure stood, cloaked and solemn, examining the artwork around him as if searching for a missing piece of a puzzle. Azazel appeared in the archway, holding a tattered piece of cloth that once belonged to his murdered son, Azrael. He taunted his brother, Raphael, by his ability to enter a house of God without hindrance, revealing the truth that Raphael had withheld those who stood against heaven during that conflict, including their own children, through a curse fueled by the blood of Azrael, Azazel's slain son. Without wasting a moment, Azazel brandished his spear blade, launching himself at Raphael, who readied his halberd spearhead blade. The clash of their weapons shattered glass objects in the vicinity, emitting a high-pitched sound that only animals could hear. Flocks of birds fell from the sky, their migration disrupted by the tremendous force of the battle. Azazel disclosed that Raphael had unknowingly met Azrael, who had become the very blade Azazel wielded after his tragic demise. A spectral image of Azrael briefly materialized from the blade, and a flurry of blinding strikes filled the chapel. As the confrontation paused momentarily, both adversaries remained unhurt and unyielding. Raphael, recognizing his brother's vanity, proclaimed that he foresaw the end of their conflict, just as their father had predicted. In a surprising move, Raphael initiated a feigned attack, catching Azazel off guard, using their momentum against him. Raphael impaled Azazel on the unfinished section of the Sistine Chapel's roof. Black and blood streamed down the hilt of Raphael's spear as Azazel's life slipped away. In his final moments, Azazel whispered to Raphael, urging him to join them in death and allow justice to be served. In a blinding flash of light, resembling that of an atomic bomb, visible for miles, but causing no harm, the battle reached its climax. As the glow subsided, people gathered at the entrance of the chapel, awestruck by what they witnessed. Burned into the stone of Michelangelo's unfinished masterpiece were the haunting outlines of Raphael, Azazel, and Azrael, a testament to the cataclysmic end of their conflict.
Hello, John.
Who are you?
I am the architect. I created the Matrix. I've been waiting for you.
You have many questions, and though the process has altered your consciousness, you remain irrevocably human. Ergo, some of my answers you will understand, and some of them you will not. Concurrently, while your first question may be the most pertinent, you may or may not realize it is also the most irrelevant.
Why am I here?
Your life is the sum of a remainder of an unbalanced equation inherent to the programming of the Matrix. You are the eventuality of an anomaly which, despite my sincerest efforts, I have been unable to eliminate from what is otherwise a harmony of mathematical precision. While it remains a burden assiduously avoided, it is not unexpected and thus not beyond a measure of control, which has led you inexorably here.
You haven't answered my question.
Quite right. Interesting. That was quicker than the others.
Others?
How many?
Others?
What? Answer my question.
The Matrix is older than you know. I prefer counting from the emergence of one integral anomaly to the emergence of the next, in which case this is the sixth version.
Five ones before me.
There are only two possible explanations.
There were five ones before me.
Either no one told me, or no one knows.
Precisely. As you are undoubtedly gathering, the anomaly is systemic, creating fluctuations in even the most simplistic equations.
You can't control me!
I'm gonna smash you to bits! Get to death!
I'm gonna kill you!
You can't make me do anything, white prick!
Choice. The problem is choice.
The first Matrix I designed was quite naturally perfect. It was a work of art, flawless, sublime. A triumph equaled only by its monumental failure. The inevitability of its doom is apparent to me now as a consequence of the imperfection inherent in every human being. Thus I redesigned it, based on your history, to more accurately reflect the varying grotesqueries of your nature. However, I was again frustrated by failure. I have since come to understand that the answer eluded me because it required a lesser mind, or perhaps a mind less bound by the parameters of perfection. Thus the answer was stumbled upon by another, an intuitive program, initially created to investigate certain aspects of the human psyche. If I am the father of the Matrix, she would undoubtedly be its mother.
The Oracle.
Please. As I was saying, she stumbled upon a solution whereby nearly 99% of all test subjects accepted the program as long as they were given a choice, even if they were only aware of the choice at a near unconscious level. While this answer functioned, it was obviously fundamentally flawed, thus creating the otherwise contradictory systemic anomaly that, if left unchecked, might threaten the system itself. Ergo, those that refuse the program, while a minority, if unchecked, would constitute an escalating probability of disaster.
This is about Zion.
You are here because Zion is about to be destroyed. Its every living inhabitant terminated, its entire existence eradicated.
Bullshit.
Bullshit!
Denial is the most predictable of all human responses. But rest assured,
kidnap Mr. Sandy Claus?
I want to do it.
Let's draw straws.
Jack said we should work together.
Three of a kind.
Birds of a feather, now and forever.
La 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 la. Kidnap the Santa Claus, lock him up real tight. Throw away the key and then turn off all the lights.
First we're going to set some bait inside the nasty trap and wait. When he comes sniffing, we will snap the trap and close the gate.
Wait, I've got a better plan to catch this big red lobster man. Let's pop him in a boiling pot, and when he's done, we'll butter him up.
Kidnap the Sandy Claus, throw him in a box. Bury him for 90 years, then see if he talks.
Then Mr. Oogie Boogie Man can take the whole thing over then.
He'll be so pleased, I do declare.
three times, and when he answers, Sandy Claus will be no more.
You're so stupid. Think now, if we blow him up to smithereens, we may lose some pieces, and then Jack will beat us black and green.
Kidnap the Sandy Claus, tie him in a bag, throw him in the ocean, then see if he is sad. Because Mr. Oogie Boogie is the meanest guy around. If I were on his boogie list, I'd get out.
I'll bet.
Perhaps he'll make his special brew.
A snake and spider's food.
We're his little henchmen, and we take our job with pride.
We do our best to please him and stay on his good side.
I wish my cohorts weren't so dumb.
I'm not the dumb one. You're no fun.
Shut up.
Make me.
I've got something.